Kia ora, good evening. Deciding how pristine and crystal clear we expect the region's water to be is up for discussion over the coming weeks as Environment Southland consult the public on the government's water and land project. In the south, there are areas facing water quality and quantity issues due to land use changes. ES are identifying and informing regional communities about the issues and how they intend to respond.
So the government have told us that we've got to set catchment limits and their water quality and water quantity. So there's issues around how much water we can take out of a water body, and there's also issues about how much contaminants can go in and how much the environment can cope with. So the first thing that we're actually doing is changing our existing rule structure, and that's the focus of our public meetings next week. So we've got a water and land plan, so we're going to have a look at the existing rules, simplify them, streamline them, and start to get people thinking about what they can do now to help them when catchment limits come in a few years' time.
So can you give me some examples about what that might be?
There are rules in the current plan around dairying. We know that they don't work particularly well, so we want to see if we can make those a bit easier for everybody to use and to understand. There's rules around water quality and water quantity. Some of those don't necessarily do now what we need them to do, bearing in mind that this plan was written quite a few years ago and things have changed. So part of it's about getting us up to speed with where the environment's at now.
So there may have been some deterioration in water quality over that time since that original plan was set up. What are the expectations from public around water quality? How pristine do we expect the waters to be?
Well, that's one of the really key issues actually, is being able as a community to decide what people value about water and what we can and can't do with it. So clearly there's going to be some constraint between having really pristine water and being able to use the water. And so the catchment limit process is about finding the middle ground and finding what as a community we can accept and what we will and won't be able to do with our water.
As far as the meetings go, you've got several around the region coming up over the next week or so. What can people expect if they come along to attend?
Yeah, so this is the first series of meetings and we're planning to have these all throughout the year and just to give people updates on what's happening. The first series of meetings is about raising community awareness. It's about telling people what the issues are, what we do know and what the things that we don't know that we need to find out. So they'll hear about our science work and our economic work that we're doing that's going to underpin that catchment limit setting process, as well as hearing about our water and land plan, which is the focus for 2015.
What sectors potentially could be affected the most by any changes?
Obviously there's always issues in terms of the rural sector, and so that's really important, but there's also issues around domestic infrastructure. So some of the stormwater systems in town potentially aren't doing what we need them to do, so it actually affects all of us. People think that it's a rural issue, but it's a region-wide issue. So the way that I wash my car in town has an impact on water quality. The way that somebody, you know, irrigates land in country has an effect on water quality.
And the first meeting gets underway this Tuesday evening at Elmwood Gardens, with other meetings scheduled for Gore and Te Tapiri soon after. Stewart Island's Rakiura Museum has long been awaiting a revamp, and after 15 years of planning, the ball is finally rolling. The development of a new heritage centre is underway for the island, and it looks as though residents and tourists are in for something much bigger and better.
Our current museum is a bit small, as most museums in the country turn out to be, so this new site will be twice the size we currently have, and it'll be properly conditioned to look after exhibits much better. So there were to be some refurbishment for the existing museum proposed at one stage, but it became difficult with the building regulations and changes that were required, that the consequences of cost were becoming far more attractive to go for a new building.
Who's involved in the project?
We have Margaret Hopkins as our chairperson, and we have a group of museum people that are keen on this project, and it is a community operation for all that, so really it's a matter of doing facility for community heritage and something to show our visitors and really show off about.
When will it start to get underway?
That's a pretty tall question, really. Whilst all the plans are done, Opus have done all their plans for us, and they're very comprehensive. They've been priced and the quantities are all set. We would think within a year or so that we should be ready to move on building operations.
Will there be new additions to the museum?
Well, certainly if it's twice the size, you know, we've got a much better scope to show people things, and there'll be audio-visual stuff and all the bit more modern method of showing people some of our heritage. lot of folks just strive to know what has happened in yesteryear, and there's been a lot of history, whaling, sealing, milling and that sort of thing here, and fishing in olden days, and we need to just have that available for folks to understand. And visitors are always curious about our current museum, a pretty good throughput through there, and there's only a small amount of the gear on show that we have available.
So are you doing projects like this to bring more visitors to the island?
Well, we want them to stay a bit longer. You know, the visitors will be coming along anyway, and we like to encourage perhaps a few more, but they need things to do, and if in fact we get a wet day occasionally, they can move inside.
Coming up after the break, Teretonga Raceway gets ready for some serious tyre action, plus the week that was. Welcome back. Teretonga Raceway near Invercargill will be abuzz with the sound of hot running motors and the aroma of burning rubber over the weekend as the Summer Fuel Festival hits the track. One competitor is Winton man Nathan Pilcher, who began driving production saloons at Speedway since the age of 15. He says traditionally it's been Holden versus Ford, but now the NZ V8s are meeting new competition on the track.
We've introduced a few new brands. We've got a couple of Toyotas, we've now got a Nissan. There's a few other brands on the cars as well, so it's diversing, which is great. It makes for more interesting racing.
How do they stack up on the track?
Oh, the Toyotas and the Nissans are fast. You know, they are really, really fast, and that's what we aspire to. All the guys that are driving these want to step up and drive, the next generation of car.
What makes a winner on the track? Is it the driver or is it a car? What's the is it a combination?
Oh, it's a combination of the two. The two really need to mix to make a winning team. It's not just the guy behind the wheel, but it's also the team off the track as well.
In the time that you've been racing the V8s, how much has technology improved with and timing results?
A lot. They're going faster and faster. The new generation cars above this are about 4 seconds quicker, and they're doing around Teretonga, they're doing in just under a sub minute, so it's very, very fast.
You are racing in every track on the South Island as part of the series. How's this going?
Good. We've got two rounds in South Island. We were at Christchurch last weekend. We had an up and down weekend last weekend, which was a bit of a shame, but hopefully we can remedy the issues that we had and have a good strong weekend here to bank some good points.
I understand that it is points based, but also overall of the series as well as the winner on the day.
Yep, we all have our own wee battles between teams, which is always fun, but at the moment we're sitting fifth in the championship, and there's only, I think, a matter of about 30 points between third, fourth and fifth, so moving forward hopefully we can come out of this weekend with a going up in the championship.
The price of fuel's in your favour at the moment, but how else is it funded? It must be quite a cost to keep this on the road.
It is, between myself and my very understanding partner Kirsten, she's a huge help as well, so it's very expensive. I couldn't do it without all my sponsors, Poscom, Classic Car Warehouse, local ones, ProTech Engines, my team who are yet to arrive, they should be here shortly, they'll be here, but I couldn't do it without them, so yeah.
Is there much competition between the local lads? There's yourself and Lee McDonald and Grant Malloy all in competing on this track?
Yeah, everyone wants to take home the local glory. We don't get anything for it. There's no prize money or anything. We're just going for bragging rights. And it is very, very strong, the competition between us local guys.
How far can you take this from here?
The limits are endless. We can go to Bathurst. Just being in the right place, right time, showing some talent, having the budget to do it is a big thing, and moving forward from there.
How much does budget reflect on the power or the performance of the vehicle on the track?
The more that you can replace your tyres, the more that you can replace your brakes, the better off you'll be. You just get the best out of the car all the time. And you're looking at about 65 grand to run one of these cars for six weekends. So it's a big cost. And to be the best, you've got to be funding that amount of money.
Finally, the track surfaces and the areas that you've been racing, Teretonga stacking up?
Teretonga's always a great track. It's fun being home. It's the best thing is we don't have to travel afterwards. But like Pukekohe's great. It's an exhilarating track. Hampton Downs is a great facility. And then, yeah, down here, you can't beat Teretonga. It's just a great flat-out track where everyone's so close.
Does it give the homeboys an advantage, do you think?
Absolutely, yeah. We're hopefully going to use it to our advantage, and you'll see us sort of towards the pointy end of the field.
And we'll have more on Monday's bulletin from Teretonga. Now it's time to leave you with some of the images that told the stories over the past week. From the news team, good night.
See you in a video.